What's going on, ladies and gents? It's Scott here, bringing you a brand new Fallout 4 build on Fudge Muppet. Today we have one of our most aesthetic builds to date, the Tribal, and we've created her to play through Fallout 4 emulating the combat style of a Deathclaw. She can sneak up on enemies silently and tear them apart, but at the same time, if her ambush fails, she is still a tanky machine of death, slashing her foes apart with a claw. This build looks sensational, and it plays very smoothly, and it's heaps of fun. If you're enjoying these builds, be sure to subscribe, especially if you want to see content for Wasteland Workshop and the Far Harbor DLC. Speaking of which, I'm proud to announce that we're going to be giving away 10 season passes at our communities on IMSI. We've got a Fudge Muppet community, a Fallout one, and an Elder Scrolls one, and we're going to give away 5 season passes at random to people who join, and another 5 season passes will be given away in a special thread on the Fudge Muppet community to 5 people who can answer the secret question, what's in my hand? Also, make sure you post any build ideas you might have in the official build ideas thread. The invite links are in the description. The Tribal build won't be using any power armor, and she absolutely doesn't have to. She'll have no problem staying alive in battle, and tends to avoid things that are overly scientific. If you've never used the Deathclaw Gauntlet before, you'll definitely enjoy this build, especially considering that it has its own awesome finishes which you may have not seen. It has a harsh, gnarly feel to it, and that's exactly what we wanted for the Tribal when it comes to battle. The Tribal is fearless, and she'll have no hesitation when it comes to risking her own life to protect those that she cares about. From her perspective, if she's not willing to die, then she's already dead. To help you navigate throughout the video, there are timestamp links in the description which are very helpful if you want to skip through a section or go back somewhere to remember information. Now it's time to meet the Tribal and to discover who she was before her life was changed forever. By the way, thanks to Rygar and Vaporware for giving us a bit of backstory inspiration on IMSI. The Tribal was born into a calm and affectionate family who lived in a small house on the outskirts of Boston. She was a single child, and her parents were both very health-conscious citizens who loved to take care of their body and their mind. They spent a lot of their day meditating and doing yoga, and they only ate or drank organic products. They believed that family and health were the two most important things in life, and these principles were taken on by the Tribal as she grew up. Her parents also felt that mental and physical exercise were very important, and from a young age, the Tribal was groomed to be physically elite. They were quite possessive of their child, and the Tribal felt likewise towards them. They were a tight group, and as much as parents considered homeschooling their child, they decided to send her to a public school so that she could socialize. Unfortunately, the young girl wasn't one for making lots of friends, and for the majority of her schooling life, she found many of those around her to be absolutely disgusting. This was mainly because of their eating habits. She knew what was in their food and couldn't believe they ate it so happily. While she wasn't much of a social butterfly, it wasn't long before she formed herself a small group of people who she liked, and this group of friends stayed quite limited. In regards to her academic pursuits, the Tribal definitely excelled past most others and received excellent results for her tests and assignments. The girl even started training for and winning Olympic lifting competitions in senior school. This trend of constant achievement continued till the end of her schooling, and over this period of time, the girl developed a lot of sympathy towards those existing around her. Their lives were off track, they were so misguided, and they would really profit from a great role model, just how she had benefited from being raised by two great parents. After finishing with school, the Tribal went on to become a lawyer. Her parents knew that optimum health was a lot easier to achieve when you could afford the best products. You had to play into the system and win at the economic game created for you, as sad as the fact actually sounded. Her law degree would allow her to get a good job, and the Tribal thought that one day she'll end up fighting for citizens' rights or some other noble cause. That said, by the time she graduated, the Tribal had other ideas in mind. She wanted to become a teacher. She wanted to give those less fortunate than herself the chance to follow a better path, to find purpose, and to live healthily. It was in her teaching career that the woman ended up meeting her future husband. It was at parent-teacher interviews, and a man who had just returned from the military service arrived with his niece. He was filling in for his brother, a man who had spent most of his time away from the family. The Tribal admired the man for his family values, and the two got on very well. At the end of the meeting, they slyly exchanged contact details, and after a year of dating, the two ended up married. The Tribal was a natural carer and always found herself looking after a group of people that needed her protection and guidance. She had taught for many years and changed the lives of her students greatly, but now she'd become too caught up in a new group, a much smaller one. her new family. The tribal ended up giving birth to a child and settled down with her husband in a new house. Their future appeared bright and exciting until, of course, the bombs began to fall and the tribal was hurried into Vault 111. Next, I'm going to be going over the faction choices and motives of the tribal. This section will, of course, talk about existing factions in the games, so if this is something you don't want to hear, then use the timestamps in the description to skip through it. We won't spoil anything major at all, except for what happens in the vault, and with that said, let's get into it. Stepping out of the Vault 111 and into the wasteland, the tribal will find herself very disoriented. She will feel a lot more primal than ever before. The cryogenic freezing technology from the vault has impacted her brain majorly, and she's no longer the highly loving, thoughtful woman she used to be. She is still cunning, however, her academic knowledge was destroyed, mainly because her memory was so fragmented and damaged. What remains is the traumatic thoughts of her family in the vault. Her desires, her emotional feelings towards the world around her, and her instincts are also intact. As she ventures fearlessly into the wasteland, she will rapidly regress into a state of being that focuses entirely on survival and hypervigilance against those that would harm her new tribe. We recommend that this new tribe is the Minutemen. The tribal would view the Institute, the Brotherhood, and the Railroad as external forces trying to extract a price from the innocent people of the Commonwealth. The settlers who are trying to survive, the settlers that the tribal must unite and protect by any means possible. That said, you could decide to join one of these groups, such as the Brotherhood, because it appears to be the strongest tribe, or you think technology needs to be controlled. That said, we do think that the Minutemen is the best choice for this build by far. The whole idea of the big factions trying to enforce their beliefs on others will make this character act pretty wild. Overall, the tribal will seek out her son while assisting her new tribe, which she will help grow to prominence. She will avoid technology for the most part and sticks to the basics in life. The less she has to rely on technology, the better, although she still enjoys a well-crafted meal. The tribal crawls into the wasteland with 8 strength, 1 perception, 5 endurance, 1 charisma, 3 intelligence, 9 agility, and 1 luck. The special book and sanctuary will be allocated into the intelligence stat, making it 4, and this will help you level at a more acceptable pace. 8 strength, 5 endurance, and 9 agility showcase the physical capacity of the tribal that has been developed over her entire life, and these stats will be very helpful when it comes to your playstyle. 9 agility will allow for plenty of VATs with the Blitz perk, and also gives you access to stealth-based perks such as Sneak and Ninja. 5 endurance helps your character stay alive and will be built up over time with experience, and 8 strength allows for plenty of melee damage. It also gives you more carry weight, not that you desperately need it. 3 intelligence represents the brain damage that was done to the tribal in the vault, and 1 charisma showcases the lack of energy that the tribal has when it comes to speech. She prefers having experiences with people and enjoying their company a lot more than actually talking with them. In regards to our other stats, there's really not that much to say. With that fully explained, let's go through all the perks that the tribal is going to acquire as she goes from level 1 to level 50. If you want to change anything around, you can, however, this is what we've decided to pick to make the best tribal and also emulate the behavior of a Deathclaw. So straight out of the vault, we're going to choose the Iron Fist perk for 20% more punching damage, and this is of course the foundation for this build's combat effectiveness. She needs to be powerful regardless of whether or not she's using stealth. Next up, we have the first rank of Blitz, which is an incredibly beast choice for any close range build, and this is going to allow the tribal to basically teleport around the battlefield. At the first rank, your VAT's distance of melee and unarmed will be increased drastically. This allows you to get up and close to the faces of enemies while using VATs throughout your playthrough. VATs can be used very often due to the tribal's high agility, and speaking of agility, this build will then collect 2 ranks of the Sneak perk. This will make her 30% harder to detect while sneaking, and she'll no longer trigger floor-based traps. This doesn't include mines yet, however, we love the whole concept of a tribal being so comfortable in movement that she can easily walk over traps without setting them off. At level 6, we get the Ninja perk, and funnily enough, this doesn't seem to work as intended, but it is still definitely worth it. Basically, what seems to happen is that you get the sneak attack bonus for ranged weapons instead of the melee bonus. So what this means is that at the first rank, your punching sneak attacks will do 2.5 times as much normal damage. It's a little annoying, but it's still highly effective. Following this, we're going to be getting the first rank of Rooted, and this is great in combination with Blitz. Now, while standing still, the tribal will cause 25% more punching damage, and she'll have plus 25 damage resistance. At level 8, she acquires the Action Girl perk, and at the first rank, this causes action points to regenerate 25% faster. This is great for the playstyle of the build, as she uses a lot of VATs and a lot of sprinting. While you do have Blitz, this character will often sprint up to targets to power attack them. Funnily enough, this can take advantage of Rooted as well if you let go of the movement controls before you land your attack. These attacks get buffed even more next with the second rank of Iron Fist, causing this build to dish out 40% more punching damage and have a chance to disarm her opponents. This is great for enemies using weapons that are dangerous, such as shotguns and missile launchers. It's pretty silly that enemies in Fallout 4 will shoot you at close range with missiles and mini nukes, but it's definitely a fact you shouldn't ignore. Speaking of avoiding damage, we'll be taking a lot less after we get the moving target perk. We choose this next, and at the first rank, it grants the tribal plus 25 damage and energy resistance while sprinting. This works perfectly with the rooted strategy I talked about earlier. While you sprint up to your enemy, you'll have high resistances, and then when you attack and release the movement controls, you'll have the resistance and damage bonus of rooted. At this point in the game, we decided to start introducing crafting. We're going to be getting the first rank of armor to start tinkering with our leather, and then we're going to be getting the third rank of sneak. Now you'll no longer set off enemy mines, and you'll be 40% harder to detect. At level 13, we get the second rank of armor to make our leather even better, and then the tribal will spend 2 perk points on the endurance stat. We chose this to beef up the tribal and make her more like a Deathclaw, hard to kill as well as deadly. We're also going to be picking the solar powered perk later on, after some more investment in endurance. At level 16, we get the second rank of ninja, making our sneak attacks do 3 times as much normal damage, and at level 17, the tribal gets another point of strength, and this represents her becoming more powerful physically as she spends time adventuring in the wasteland. Each point of strength makes you do 10% more melee and unarmed damage, so having this bonus is really useful. This punching damage upgrade continues next with the third rank of Iron Fist, and this grants the tribal 60% more of this damage, and also gives her a chance to cripple her enemy's limbs when using a power attack. At level 19, we're going to get the second rank of Action Girl, so AP regens 50% faster, and as expected, this will help with more VATS usage and constant streams of Blitz. Finally, at level 20, the tribal actually gets the Aqua Girl perk, allowing her to breathe underwater and take no radiation damage while swimming. We wanted this as it definitely fits with the tribal concept of nature and being able to comfortably survive and exist in various environments. To further add to the idea of thriving in various terrains, the tribal will then get 2 ranks of rad resistance in a row. Usually we're not too fond of this perk, however, because this build doesn't use power armor and won't use the hazmat suit, we thought it was pretty cool. We decided to stick with the most primal things possible, and a hazmat suit is far from primitive. With 2 ranks of this, the tribal will gain plus 20 rad resistance, and while it's not super necessary, you will still find it useful. At level 23, the tribal will get sneak 4, and at this rank, she'll be 50% harder to detect while sneaking. Running will also no longer affect stealth negatively, and this is great in combination with our leather leg modification, sleek. Following this is the second rank of rooted, and this will let you cause 50% more punching damage and have plus 50 damage resistance while standing still. Again, this goes great with moving target if you learn how to use them properly, and we're going to be picking the second rank of this next. Now the tribal will receive plus 50 damage and energy resistance while sprinting. She's further fortified at level 26 with a third rank of armorer, and then at level 27 she picks the final rank of rad resistant. Now you'll have a handy plus 30 rad resistance. Next it's time to start drinking your raw milk and make your bones strong with the first rank of adamantium skeleton. This will make the tribal take 30% less limb damage and is very important as 1. She doesn't use power armor, 2. Tough enemies like explosive turrets will start becoming more common, and 3. You're always fighting up close, making you more vulnerable to limb damage. At level 29, this build gets an absolute beast perk rank, and this is Blitz rank number 2. This perk will increase your VAT's melee unarmed distance even further, and it will cause you to deal more damage the further the Blitz distance is. This is a very powerful perk rank and will definitely take the tribal to new heights. Finally, at level 30, she gets the second rank of adamantium skeleton, reducing limb damage by 60%. It's time to pack some more punching power into this build with the fourth rank of Iron Fist. Punching attacks will now do a massive 80% more damage, and power attacks will have an increased chance to cripple one of your opponent's limbs. Adamantium Skeleton 3 is then chosen to completely eliminate limb damage, and this is followed by the third rank of Ninja. This rank will cause your sneak attacks to do 3.5 times as much normal damage. 2 ranks of Endurance follow this, and if you've got the Endurance bobblehead, your endurance will finally be 10. In terms of stats, this completes the transformation of this build into a character who is not only super strong, but also very hard to kill and also difficult to see coming. Very much like the Deathclaw species itself. The tribal is fortified further at levels 36 and 37 with 2 ranks of toughness, adding a handy 28 points to the damage resistance of this build. Sneak 5 is chosen next for the tribal, and at this rank ensuring she can engage stealth to make distant enemies lose track of her. She will often do this if she is compromised when she absolutely didn't want to be. She can flee and then come back from a new angle to cause devastation to her foes. Following this is the final rank of Armorer, and is chosen to fully max out our armor modification choices, and then we're going to be getting the first rank of Solar Powered. Remember, this is the 10th endurance perk, and you will need to have collected the bobblehead to access it. With one rank of this perk, the tribal will gain +2 strength and +2 endurance between the hours of 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. This is great for having even more health and causing more damage, as you'll end up with 12 strength and 12 endurance during the day. It's also neat for role-playing, as it plays into more tribal themes. You could even view it as some sort of pagan worship of the sun. As we journey towards level 50, the tribal will actually get 2 ranks of medic at levels 41 and 42. Stimpaks will now restore 60% of max HP, and Radaway will remove 60% of max potential radiation. This is great for helping this build stay alive as enemies get much stronger, and also for traversing radiated areas in our tribal gear without having to resort to a hazmat suit. This is especially important for close quarters builds too, because enemies will often cause you radiation damage. Next we get the final rank of Rooted, and while we're standing still, melee attackers may randomly be disarmed after they strike us. The tribal then invests in the final rank of Moving Target, making sprinting cost 50% less AP. Again, like many agility perks, this is highly advantageous for the VAT's playstyle of the build. Following this, Toughness 3 will give us +30 damage resistance, and Iron Fist 5 will be chosen afterwards to make us deal double damage with punching weapons. This rank will also allow the tribal to paralyze our opponents with a critical hit. The tribal is by no means a luck character, however, because of her constant VAT strikes, she will often have a critical hit saved up to make this perk useful. At levels 47 and 48, the Toughness perk will be chosen and finished off, leaving the tribal with a beneficial +50 damage resistance. Finally, at level 49 and 50, the last two ranks of Solar Powered will be unlocked, giving this build some extra durability in the late game stages. The second rank of Solar Powered will make radiation slowly fade away over time, and the third rank will make health slowly regenerate. Now you've got yourself the ultimate tribal character, regenerating energy while out in the wilderness as she uses her stealth prowess and brawling ability to survive against and hunt down any wasteland threats. The endgame special stats, including all the bobbleheads, will be 10 strength, 2 perception, 10 endurance, 2 charisma, 5 intelligence, 10 agility, and 2 luck. Gear for the tribal is pretty straightforward to understand, so there's no need to split it into early game, mid game, and end game segments. Firstly though, let's talk about the raw aesthetic of the character. What you're going to want to do is create a tribal looking aesthetic. We went for a real Celtic look. Deep red hair, shaven on the side with an unladylike hairstyle, and of course the tribal face paint design. We made this blue and added the throat smudge design, also blue, to emulate the appearance of Woad. Now onto the gear. The character will be wearing leather armor for the entire game. However, once you find sturdy leather, you're going to want to wear that. We decided that nothing would be worn underneath this leather to achieve the most tribal aesthetic possible, especially because you see bare feet. However, you can decide to wear something like the harness if you really want to. Your full set of sturdy leather armor will be modified and made treated, and this gives you better resistances, but also a more red looking leather, making it closer in color to your hair. In terms of modifications, the endgame choices are as follows. On the chest piece, we're going with pneumatic, which reduces the magnitude of incoming staggers, and on the arms, we went with weighted. Weighted will make your melee and unarmed attacks ignore some of your target's armor, which is extremely cool for a character using a weapon with sharp, piercing claws. Finally, on the legs, we decided to go with a sleek modification, and this increases movement speed while sneaking. This will help us navigate the battlefield faster without being seen, and fits in with the whole agile tribal theme of the build. In terms of earlier game armor mods, you'll want to make your standard leather chest piece padded or pocketed, and then dense when you can. For the arms, you would likely want to use something like brawling to improve unarmed damage, and on the legs, you could go with strengthened to reduce your limb damage. Overall, we recommend using mods that you find useful early on. However, once you've got all the ranks of Armorer, we strongly recommend using our endgame recommendations. In terms of weaponry, the tribal will of course be using the Deathclaw Gauntlet, and you'll definitely want to upgrade it. Luckily, this requires no crafting perks, and if you want to know how to acquire the Deathclaw Gauntlet, we'll link the video we made on how to get it in the description. Before getting this weapon, you'll have to use whatever unarmed based weapons you can find, perhaps something like the Furious Power Fist. You can find that at Swan's Pond. Like many stealth characters, the Tribal isn't too fussed when it comes to companions. They can compromise her stealth, and this can definitely be a hindrance. However, if you must have a companion, then we recommend either Dogmeat or Strong. Obviously, Dogmeat fits in with the whole wilderness theme of this build, and if you decide to go with the Brotherhood, then Strong isn't the best. However, if you side with the Minutemen like we recommend, then Strong can be pretty cool. Being a super mutant, he is very used to living away from civilization, and is great for melee combat as well. Do remember that having no companion is often the best choice, especially if you use stealth a lot. When it comes to settlements, the Tribal will literally treat them as if they are her tribes. She will set up many around the wasteland, building up their presence as she gathers settlers to work them. That said, she tends to only focus on the main necessities such as food and water. She can build various things to increase happiness, however she's not into anything fancy. Also, once the Wasteland Workshop DLC arrives, it would be very cool for this character to tame creatures and set up a battle arena. And that concludes our latest Fallout 4 build, the Tribal. Thanks for tuning in, and be sure to subscribe for more Fallout 4 and other gaming related videos. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you want to see more Fudge Muppet content, be sure to come over to IMSI, add us on Snapchat, and follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. My name is Scott, this was The Tribal, and I look forward to nerding out with you all once again very soon.